I am starting the next block about theory and simulations, and I'm going to talk about crystal structure prediction at high pressure. Well, I think Valentin showed something similar in a previous slide, so you have that the basis of the properties of a material is the structure. So given the structure, we can know if this material is soft, it is hard, it is a superconductor. Everything is hidden in the structure of a material. And since we are talking about crystals, we refer to the lattice parameters and the atomic positions. So, diamond and graphite, in spite of being composed of carbon atoms, have very different properties. So, graphite is a soft material, whereas diamond is the hardest known material. Why we study crystal structure at high pressure? Well, the pressure is the essential parameter to modify the structure of a material. And since the range of pressure spans for more than 60 orders of magnitude in the universe, we have that pressure can turn liquids into spectacular crystals, change gases into exotic metals by modification of the interatomic distances and bond angles. Probably the most important phenomenon associated to pressure is polymorphism. So we can access to different crystal structures, different polymers through phase transitions, and we can get unexpected chemical and physical properties. So elements become superconductors, metals transform to insulators, molecules break down, and new reactions are possible. Some examples of it. We have here two phase diagrams of silicon dioxide and carbon dioxide. You can see that we have different polymers for each of these materials. You can see that there are lots of polymers. Another one. With pressure, you can turn an element into a semiconductor. In the figure, I'm showing different elements that become superconductors under high pressure. There are 23, for instance, iron, phosphorus, and also the pressure affects the critical superconducting temperature of the ambient pressure superconductors, increasing it. But pressure affects to the superconductivity not only of elements, but also of other materials. For instance, some days ago, it was confirmed experimentally that hydrogen sulfide is the superconductor with the highest critical superconducting temperature, around 200 Kelvin. We have also that metals metals transfer to insulator. In the figure, I plot the HP4 phase of sodium. It appears at a pressure at around 200 GPa, and this phase is a direct band gap insulator with an incredibly high band gap, and also is transparent. The insulator character has been explained traditionally through the opening of a band gap between the what they are called the valence and conduction bands. But we can see also it, in this case, plotting an L-plane of the structure. I think Julia is going to talk about the ELF a lot in the next talk, but you can understand it as a way of measuring the localization of electrons. So in this material, the electrons, in spite of being distributed around all the atoms, are strongly localized. This function goes from 0 to 1, and 1 is red and 0 is blue. So you can see here that the electrons are strongly localized in interstitial sites with almost no connection between them. This is an explanation of the insulator character of this material. The traditional approach to study to solve the crystal structure at high pressure is coupling a diamond anvil cell with different characterization techniques such as X-ray, neutron diffraction, and Raman. Well, you can also use shockwave, but this is the traditional approach. This approach faces some problems. Some of them are, well, the main problem is that you need to have the material in your hands. Then you you can have a small size of the sample, you can have a lack of hydrophraticity, a lack of crystallinity, well, lots of problems. You can access to high pressures, but maybe not to the pressures that you find in giant planets such as Jupiter. On the other hand, theory allows you to deal with ideal samples and any conditions. So it complements experiments, but it also has interpretative and predictive abilities. It's not exempt of problems. Some of them rely on the approximations you need to do, and that the comparison between experiment and theory is not always so easy. So theoretically, and as it was noted by Maddox some years ago, one of the continuous scandals in the physical science is that it's impossible to predict the tractor only from the knowledge of the chemical composition of a material. In other words, is what the tractor will a collection of atoms adopt. We have here a collection of atoms, and we ask which tractor it will have. So, the problem we face is the minimization of a complex energy surface, represented on the right. You can visualize it as a collection of mountains and valleys. The bottom of the valleys, well, here, are the local minima, and the hillsides enclosing the local minima are the attraction basins. You are interested in getting the lowest minima of the structure. Ideally, what you do is you minimize the Gibbs-free energy. But since the vibrational contributions to the Gibbs-free energy are usually quite difficult to calculate, they are computationally quite expensive, we rely on the enthalpy. That is, the Gibbs-free energy, but at zero temperature and without including the zero-point vibrations. I'm plotting here a one-dimensional scheme. So we have the energy, the configuration coordinate. You have local minima, but we are interested in getting the global minimum. The dimensionality of this problem is 3n plus 3, where n is the number of the atoms. And it has been calculated that the number of local minima increases exponentially with the number of atoms. So it's impossible to predict the structure of a material containing, for instance, 20 atoms, just exploring the whole energy surface. So since we cannot afford an exhaustive exploration of the energy surface, we have to rely on an efficient exploration of it and accurate evaluation of it. To accurately evaluate it, we use, for instance, some methods such as DFT. Probably most of you have used it. So, some properties of the energy surfaces can be exploited to facilitate this search. So, for instance, some big regions of the energy surface corresponds to very high energy extractors, so we are not interested in them. Then, going from one minimum to another minimum is more likely if the activation barrier is small. Basins with lower energy minima usually tend to have larger areas, or lower energy minima usually corresponds to highly symmetric structures. The traditional theoretical approach to crystal structure prediction is just calculating the energy of a number of candidate structures. These structures can be chosen following structural analogies with other similar compounds or other models such as the anion metallic in metallic matrix models. I think I will comment later. In the figure, I am plotting the energy versus volume for different phases of aluminium. From these energy volume points, we can calculate pressure volume data, and they can be describe that equation of states, and we can access to the Boole modulus, the first derivative of the Boole modulus, the equilibrium unit cell configuration, and the Gibbs-free energy. But what's the problem? The problem is that experimental data, or at least chemical intuitions, are needed. The crystal structure prediction methods can be classified in two big groups. The first one is the semi-local methods. They need a good initial starting guess, a good initial structure with quite low energy, since the exploration of the structures is going to be performed in the neighborhood of this low energy structure. These semi-local methods are the simulated annealing, the minima hopping, the Bayesian hopping, and the metadynamics. I'm going to highlight some ideas of them. The simulated annealing is based on a metallurgic process where we heated a material or a metal to reduce defects. So when a metal melts, those atoms are in a disordered state in which atomic diffusion and kinetic barriers crossing is allowed. If we decrease abruptly the temperature, the material usually crystallizes with lots of vacancies and other defects. But if the cooling is slow enough, the atoms arrange in a global minimum. This is the idea. So we start from a candidate structure, and this structure is perturbed using random atomic displacements, atomic mutations, change of lattice parameters. We can see here a scheme, and how we decide which of these random movements is accepted or not. Well, we apply a Mercopolis criterion, so the movements are accepted if we define a parameter epsilon, and if this parameter epsilon that goes from 0 to 1 is smaller than this probability. This probability is given by the difference in energy between the two structures. This is the Boltzmann constant, and this is a fictitious temperature. The simulation starts at a high temperature, so most of the new configurations are accepted, but then we reduce the temperature, so fewer high energy configurations are accepted, and hopefully we will get to the global minimum. The problem is that usually we get stuck in one of the local minima. The efficiency of these methods depends strongly on the type and magnitude of the movements, and also in the way we apply the temperature decreasing. This is the simulated annealing. Another related method is the Bayesian hopping. It's quite similar, but it relaxes each structure to its local minima. So we start from a structure, we relax to its local minima, then we apply a deformation, we relax to their local minima, and the Mercopolis criterion is applied on the local minima. We have a stepwise function. It's important because the barriers between this local minimum are smaller than between the original structures. It reduces the noise of the energy surface. Also, the temperature in this case can be decreased, but also it can be maintained. In analogy with the previous methods, the efficiency depends on the type and magnitude of the moves, and also in the choice of how temperature is perturbed. Another method is minima hopping. It uses molecular dynamics. It starts from a local minimum. You perform a molecular dynamic simulation step. You get to another structure. This structure is relies to a local minima. And this structure is accepted is the difference in energy between the new structure and the previous structure is less than this parameter, EDIF, yeah. This parameter is modified along the simulation. What does it mean? We start from a local minimum. We perform a molecular dynamic step. We get to another minimum. After realization, we calculate the energy of both of them, the original and the last one. Okay, if the new energy minus the previous energy is less than this EDIF, we accept the new minimum and we start the procedure. Also, we decrease this EDIF by a factor. If that's not the case, we reject the new minimum and we increase this EDIF. This method is also based in the Bell-Evans-Polanyi principle. According to it, lower energy minima and exothermic reactions are related to small kinetic barriers.
This is a figure.
So, since we are performing molecular dynamics, we need to assure that the kinetic energy is small enough to hop into the lower neighboring minima. But it can be too low, since if it's too low, we will need lots of molecular dynamics steps. But still, if it's too high, we are visiting lots of undesirable minimums. So the procedure can be divided into an inner loop and outer loop. In the inner loop, we perform the molecular dynamic simulation and the kinetic energy is adjusted. And in the outer loop, we decide if the new minima is accepted or not by changing this EDIF. In that way, that most 50% of the structures tend to be accepted. Well, finally, the last of these methods is based on, instead of this approach, is the calculation of phase transition. So we want to simulate a phase transition. Imagine you know the structure of a material and you want to study the phase transition to another structure. Ideally, we will use MPT molecular dynamics simulations, but they face the problem of the time scale. So we can only simulate those phase transitions whose kinetic barrier is less than KBT. KB is the Boltzmann constant. Usually, the solid-solid phase transitions are first order, so they involve high barriers and are slow. So that's not possible. And also, in the molecular dynamic simulations, we assume periodic boundary conditions, so we are not simulating accurately the non-heterogeneous nucleation. To overcome this problem of the kinetic barrier, we can apply like a big pressure, what is called an overpressurization. But we can skip some of the phases that are important. A related technique is metadynamics. In metadynamics, the solution is decreasing the barrier by adding a suitable potential to the original Gibbs energy landscape. If you go to Google and you Google it, I think if you put a Dutch perspective on it, you are going to find a funny animation on it. So the point is that you increase the Gibbs free energy of these basins by adding a number of Gaussians. So you discourage the dynamics from visiting these points again. And finally, when the basin of attraction is filled with Gaussians, the Gibbs free energy becomes high enough to overcome the barrier, and the system enters a new basin of attraction of a new structure. You can have see it. So you increase this Gibbs free energy, you are increasing, then the Gibbs free energy is high enough, so it can go here. The efficiency depends on the width and amplitude of the Gaussians. If they are too large, they can lead to a wrong phase transition, but if they are too small, you can require too many metadynamic steps. Other methods are the global methods. These methods, in these methods, you don't need a good initial starting guess. So if you don't have a clue about the structure of a material, these are the methods you need to use. All of them use a initially randomly generated structures, and they are the random structure searches, the evolutionary algorithms, and the particle swarm optimization technique. The easiest approach is the random searching. I'm putting here the ab initio random structure searching that is the code developed by Picard and co-workers, and is the simplest approach if you don't know anything about the system. So what does code does? Well, it explores the whole energy surface, by calculating the Gibbs free energy of a set of randomly generated structures. To generate that, you just place randomly atoms in a box of reasonable density. You optimize that, and you will get to the local minima. Hopefully, one of these local minima will be the global minimum of your system. The recipe is as simple as it follows. You just need a pressure, a volume, and a number of time of atoms. You make a random unit cell, you throw a given number of atoms of the given type into the unit cell, you relax forces and stresses, you repeat the process, and when you find the same structure a number of times, you stop the simulation because you have achieved the global minimum, hopefully. An example is plotted in this figure. The searches are performed for 1,000 structures at 1 GPA and placing 4 atoms in the unit cell. This graph represents the relative enthalpy with respect to the diamond structure, that is the stable phase at 0 Kelvin and ambient conditions, versus volume. You can see that the diamond structures appear 49 times in the simulations, but also other structures such as beta team, IMM, and simple hexagonal appear at lower volumes, and interestingly, these phases are high pressure phases of silicon. The problem we face is that the number of local minima is expected to increase exponentially with the size of the system. To overcome this problem, there are different possibilities. You can, for instance, impose constraints. To start with, you can input a reasonable volume. The volume usually depends more on the type of atoms than on the on the number of atoms that on the type of atoms, so it can give you an estimation. Or if you know other structures for this material, you can also input the space group, or you can put forcing this system to have some operators of symmetry. You can input the if you have experimental data, you can input the experimental lattice parameters. If you want to study a molecular solid, you can input instead of atoms molecules. You need to use these constraints. This is very important. Another group of methods are the evolutionary algorithms. These methods are inspired by natural evolution of a population where offspring resemble parents and procreation is a reward for success. There are different computational codes. I'm going to concentrate on USPES. That is probably one of the most commonly used codes. It starts from an initial population of structures, generally randomly created. It's in analogy with the previous method, but we need to impose some constraints. As I told you before, they can be an estimated volume. Oh, I forgot before, but you can also input like the minimum distances between the atoms for not getting unphysical structures. You can input symmetry, you can input lattice parameters, you can input like, imagine you have a structure that you know that tends to form tetrahedra, you can input this tetrahedra. Then you relax these structures and a fingerprint and a fitness are assigned to each of these structures. The fingerprint is a monodimensional function that measures like the structure characteristics of this material, let's say. And the fitness usually is the enthalpy. So from the comparison of the fingerprints of different, this is fingerprint, no fingerprint. For the comparison of the fingerprints of different structures, we can discard those structures that are similar. It prevents what is called the cancer growth. It means that one structure proliferates, creating clones and expanding everywhere. We don't want that. And according to the evaluation of the enthalpies of the structure, we can make like a ranking of energies. So we discard those structure with highest energies, and we choose a proportion of a number of structures with the lowest energies. From these structures, we create the children, so we select them as a parents. To create the children, we use different variation operators such as heredity, lattice mutation, permutation, or atomic mutations. I will show an example later. In the next generation, we get the children, but also we include some random structures to allow some diversity to be maintained in the procedure. And also, the best structure of the previous generation is included. Why we do that? Well, we want that the process must be variational, so we want that the enthalpy is decreasing, not we don't want like to go from the local minimum. So I am showing here like the operators we can apply. So for instance, in heredity, we take like some slabs. We are taking some slabs of the parents and we are generating the new structure. In the mutation, we apply a mutation of the lattice parameters. Permutation, we interchange some atoms. So we repeat the procedure until the same structure appears a number of times, or that the lowest means the lowest energy structure does not change. These methods allows you to zoom into the regions of the energy surface with the lowest energy, in difference with the random approach. So we start from a randomly structure distributed in the whole energy surface, but then they are kind of zooming into the most promising areas. Another technique is the particle swarm optimization. It's based on the behavior of the bears, of the fish. We can define a swarm as a population of particles that tend to cluster together, and apparently they are behaving randomly. But it seems to be a kind of information exchange between the particles, a self-improving evolution, or a kind of evolution guided by the optimal particle. The procedure is similar to evolutionary methods, but it doesn't include evolution operators such as heredity or mutation. The first population, which is called swarm, is randomly generated with constraints. It's the same that in USPEX. Then we apply local optimization and discarding the identical structures, same than in USPEX. Then that's the difference. A fraction of the lowest energy structures are used to produce 60% of the structures in the new generation, but this particle swarm optimization methods, and also we include some random structures in the procedure. The movement of the particles is influenced by their past experience and also the experience of the swarm. And as in evolutionary methods, it learns from history and it zooms into the most promising region of the configurational space. Here is a diagram that shows it easily. Imagine that the structures are like particles or like bears. So we are kind of flying over the whole energy surface. Xt is the position of the particle. And the next position of the particle is xt plus 1. So how we went from here to here? There are different parameters we need to consider, that as p best is the best position that the particle has already visited. So it means you have this particle, you optimize it, and you get p best. And g best is the position that the leading particle has visited. The leading particle is the particle with the lowest enthalpy. So from these parameters, we update the position of the particle according to this equation. So we have the velocity, we have a couple of terms that indicate how much you rely on the position of your particle or on the position of the swarm. And this is the idea. I'm going to talk about some applications. I think I need to be quite short. Okay, I'm going to skip this then. Okay, sorry. So, lithium at high pressure. Newton and Ashcroft predicted some years ago that lithium that goes from BCC to FCC will transform to a low symmetry paired atoms were like with the lithium, we can consider it like with the lithium, but most interestingly with near insulating properties. 1 year later, by diffraction studies, Hanfland found a transition from the BCC structure to the FCC structure and then to the CI16 structure. And later on, the CI16 structure was predicted to transform to this OC24 structure at 88 or 100 GPA. I'm plotting there a screen of different phases. You can see that CI16 and OC24 shares a trigonal coordination for the lithium atoms, while this OC8 structure has like the lithium units. This structure was proved to be not thermodynamically stable. Most recently, experiments performed by Matsuoka et al. Using resistivity and combining it with this rate located two new phases after the CI16 phase. These are the lithium 6 and lithium 7. You can notice this is resistivity on the right. So you can notice an increase of the resistivity of more than 4 orders of magnitude, and that lithium 7 is a semiconducting phase. This is clear for the behavior of the resistivity versus temperature. You can see that resistivity decreases with temperature. About that time, calculations performed by Yao and co-workers and Picard et al. Proposed a transition from this CI16 to other structures, C224, well, other structures that are slightly distortions of the CMCA24 structure. In my previous group of Edinburgh, X-ray diffraction studies were performed. They map out the whole phase diagram of lithium from 5 to 130 GPA and with temperatures between 77 and 300 Kelvin. I need to note that the experiments with lithium at high pressure are extremely difficult because it can occur a reaction of the lithium with the diamonds. We observe a transition from the CI16 to lithium 6, lithium 7, and a new phase was observed, lithium 8. The structures of lithium 6, lithium 7, and lithium 8 were proposed as OC88, OC40, and OC24. What does it mean? It means that they are orthorhombic, that's the O, they are base center, and they have 88, 40, and 24 atoms in the unit cell. After refinement, this structure was the same CMCA24 structure that has been proposed previously. And for the OC40 and OC88, we have information on the lattice parameters and on the highest space group compatible with the X-ray diffraction pattern. So these were the proposed space groups. So we perform ab initio random structure calculations using the CASTEP code, using a PBS topotential, using, well, these are parameters you put in your DFT calculation. Since we want to optimize this OC40 structure, it means you have two primitive formula units in your cell, we perform searches on 20 atoms, and we start from the initial experimental lattice parameters, but they were allowed to change during the simulation. We use also the experimental symmetry as a constraint, so we perform searches using the P21 over C, PC, or randomly selecting space groups with 4 and 2 symmetry operations, and including no symmetry at all. These space groups are subgroups of the proposed CMCA structure. The searches starting from the P21 over C led to the CMCA40 structure, but all the rest of the searches led to this crystal structure. The enthalpy calculation showed that this structure has lower enthalpy, so it's more stable. Here I'm plotting the relative enthalpy versus the shear existing structure versus pressure, and you can see that the C2CB structure is the lowest, the most stable structure from 67 to 90.5 GPa. We also predict that transition from this phase to the previously proposed PBCA and C2CB, and finally to the CMCA. In the experiments, we don't have presence of this structure, but we need to remember that experiments are performed at temperature, and we are not including temperature at all. So it can happen that this structure may be optimized by dynamical effects. And hypothetical transition from C2CB to CMCA is predicted at 91 GPa. This OC40 structure is dynamically stable. You can calculate it from calculating the phonons of this structure. You can see that there is no imaginary frequency, so it's dynamically stable. It's also a semiconductor. You can see here the band structure. You see the opening of the band. You see the opening. And it's an indirect band gap along this between some points, but this indirect band gap is very similar to the gamma direct band gap, and the gap increases with pressure. The previously proposed structures, I think I have here, all these structures were proposed to have also some band gaps, but the band gaps were lower than the current band gap. For instance, the larger gap for the other structures was 0.276 electron volts. You can think why the previous simulations didn't get to this OC40 structure, and the answer is quite simple. They didn't put the right number of atoms in the unit cell, so they performed searching using, I think, I don't remember, but 14, 16, or 24, they even put more, they put 24, but they missed this number, 20. So it gives you information on how important is the experimental theoretical cooperation, since they miss it just for not putting the right number of atoms in the searches. Well, this is a representation of the structure. Okay. This is the representation of the structure. It's quite complex. The different atoms are represented by spheres of different colors, and the red blobs correspond to the ELF isosurfaces. The next structure that was found was predicted to be orthorhombic, base center, and with 88 atoms in the unit cell. To search for this structure, we perform searches using 44 atoms, and starting from the initial experimental lattice parameters, the searches were performed using the constraint of symmetry, so we start from space groups that are subgroups of the highest space group that was proposed in the experiments. The lowest enthalpy structure we found has this space group. This structure is more stable than the rest of the phases in the experimental range of existence, but it's not more stable than CI16. So we ask ourselves if it can be stabilized by dynamical effects. This phase, well, has a complicated structure and also has a low density of states at the Fermi energy, but there is no band gap. This is the Raman of the different phases, and you can see that there are very low Raman modes for this OC88 structure. So we ask if this structure can have a low zero-point energies and also high entropies, and maybe that's why this phase is stabilized in the experiments. So we calculate the Gibbs free energies using the quasi-harmonic approximation. I told you before that in the calculations sometimes, or most commonly, we use the enthalpy, but in this, to calculate the Gibbs free energies, we need to calculate the phonons. So I'm plotting here the phonon contribution to the Helmholtz energy versus pressure at 0 Kelvin, and you can see that, in fact, the OC88 structure has lower phonon contribution to the Helmholtz energy. And also, it's in haze at temperature, so you can see here. So maybe that's the case. That's the case, that this phase can be stabilized by dynamical effects. Here I'm plotting the enthalpies, the relative enthalpies versus the CI-16 phase. You can see that the OC88 phase, red on the figure, is not stable at any pressure. But at 0 Kelvin, this phase approaches that of the CI-16. CI-16 is, we are referring to it. So it's like the blue one. Sorry. And finally, at 200 Kelvin, this phase appears as most stable at that range of pressure. So we find that including dynamic effects contributes to the stabilization of this structure. Well, I think I don't have time, no? Oh. Okay, just a couple of minutes. So, okay, so, well, you know that the carbon dioxide and silicon dioxide are quite different at ambient conditions. Carbon dioxide is a molecular gas, and silicon dioxide is a crystalline solid formed by a three-dimensional network of tetrahedra. But under pressure, this changes, and CO2 goes through a number of intermediate phases, and finally it adopts structures that are quite similar to those of silica. So we perform searches with the USPS code. We use the bus code, pseudopotential, PV, a cutoff energy. We perform searches on these compounds, and we perform these searches since we are assuming that this. We are assuming this equation. So we perform searches, we include random structures, we include structures derived from previous silicon carbon oxide polymers, we include building blocks such as tetrahedra of carbon, of silicon, CO3, CO6, we include all these units, and we perform different generations, including 40C structures. C is the number of unit cells. The convergence is reaching 30 to 60 generations. The main result is here. So you can see here I'm plotting the enthalpy formation. So it means that if the enthalpy, variation of enthalpy is less than zero, we have a stable silicon carbon oxygen compound, and we find that. So we find that for this stoichiometry, that is C2O6, there is a structure who is stable. To perform this difference in enthalpy, since we are performing calculations of enthalpy, we need to consider the enthalpies of silicon dioxide and carbon dioxide at 0 Kelvin, that are plotted here. At ambient conditions, you know that carbon dioxide and silicon dioxide don't react. So that's also a result of these enthalpy pressure curves. You can see here that delta of enthalpy is positive, so silicon oxide and carbon dioxide don't react, and in fact, the searches left to these structures, you can see the CO2 units, indicating that the reaction is not possible. But in this range, we observe that all the stoichiometries show kind of minima, and as I told you before, this stoichiometry becomes thermodynamically stable. Well, the structure is indicated here. we try to see if other structures containing, well, this structure contains this kind of units. So we think that maybe it's possible to get another structure that instead of tahedra CO carbonate units CO3 had a tetrahedra of carbon and silicon. So we calculate the enthalpies of structures derived from non-polymers of silicon oxide and carbon dioxide, and their relative enthalpies are plotted here. You can see that they are high in spite of having also a minimum around the same values of pressure with these phases stabilized. We have that they are still 1.67, 1.95 electron volts higher in enthalpy than the previous structure. So they are not stable. This is a figure containing the structure of this compound. You can see that it's a semiconductor. Well, the phonon structure indicates that there are no imaginary frequencies, so it's stable. Also, well, at a higher pressure, we have that there is a symmetrization of this structure to another structure. It only involves the displacement of the silicon atoms. The silicon atoms are the blue spheres. The displacement of the silicon atoms from the center of the faces to the middle of the edges, and a kind of symmetrization of the structure. But most importantly, at high pressure, the preferred structure, in spite of not being thermodynamically stable, contain octahedra of silicon and tetrahedra of carbon. And these are some figures where you can see that carbon adopts a tetrahedra coordination. So thank you for listening.
A lot of experiments were performed at ambient temperature where the energy barriers are very important. And did you ever try to check published structures for their stability? Because when I obtain new phase during pressurizing, I can obtain either stable phase
or
metastable with lower barrier. Did you ever try to check published structures to ensure their stability or metastability?
Yeah, well, for instance, the structures I put about lithium, they were also experimentally determined, so they were stable. But I have an example about silicon carbon dioxide that recently there was a paper claiming. A structure of silicon carbon oxide containing carbon and silicon tetrahedra. So it means that can be a metastable structure in that case. But we didn't get that from this. Well, you can, for instance, you can see that there is a difference of energy, and you can estimate a temperature from that, and you can get that you can need a kinetic barrier of that order to get the metastable structure. But getting also in the searches, sometimes you get the lowest energy structure, but also you get other structures that are metastable. But you need the experiments to prove that they are really observed. That's the point.
What is the problem to put temperature inside the calculation?
Because it's very difficult to calculate the phonons. It's not like calculating the energy. It's computationally. You need to calculate second derivatives of the energy versus displacements of atoms. And it's just a problem of
computer.
Of computer. So ideally, you will do that. You will calculate the Gibbs free energy in these methods, and you will go on, and you get the Gibbs free energy instead of enthalpy.
But this, with trying to model temperature also during calculation. I mean,
yeah, you can use molecular dynamics for that.
Yeah. So is it possible to use it? I mean, here,
yeah.
It's number of just atoms. This is the problem. So we had to use 16 atoms instead of like in crystals.
Yeah, that's also a problem of atoms. Yeah, the problem increases exponentially with the size of with the number of atoms. So obviously it depends also in the number of atoms you put here.
So So it is not possible. It is not possible to solve crystal structure from 16 atoms. Yes. So this is the problem. From 16 atoms at first, you can't solve the crystal structure. You can't find the structure of the crystal if you will solve the equation with 16 atoms and temperature.
16 yes? atoms.
You because you need more atoms. It's 100. So if you will have 100, you will get crystal structure. If you will have 8 atoms, you will not get crystal structure.
You get, because you this unit cell is repeated periodically through the whole space. That's the point of in most of the unit cells don't contain a big number of atoms.
Yeah.
You can four, well, some of them, yes, but.
Computer closed.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't get the first.
We use something like
evolutionary. Yeah.
And how the enthalpy is calculated?
How you calculate the enthalpies?
Volume pressure dependence, right?
You calculate it using a DFT code, like BAST or whatever. Well, you can in these codes you can calculate or internal energy or you can calculate directly enthalpy. If you plot a pressure on the codes, you can get also the enthalpy. You include it as a number in your code. It's a tensor, and the calculations calculate the energy. Then they add PB, where pressure is included in the bus, quantum espresso, all the traditional DFT codes do that for you. You can calculate the enthalpy, yeah, on those codes, straightforward. I am deaf.
So in the beginning of the talk, there was this electron localization function diagrams.
Electron localization function. Yeah, Julia is going to talk a lot about the electron localization function, so that's why I didn't comment much of that. I think she's going to talk about it. She's an specialist of that. So.